One of the issues that we find often asked is how do you row a pair? Pairs, notoriously one of those most difficult boats. It's a boat where you'll find that people will be saying that I'm too strong for the other guy, or I'm pulling him round in a circle, I'm pulling her around in a circle. And one of the real issues about this is it's not about the relative strength of the rowers that's important. It's how they deal with rowing a pair, because a pair is a particularly difficult boat if you don't know what you're doing. But it's one of those boats that really makes you work well together, and it's probably the ultimate team boat. For example, if one athlete's not doing the right thing, then it's a mess. Whereas in an eight, a person can hide. So pairs are a really useful boat. They're really useful for a couple of other characteristics as well that I'll explain a little bit later in this short segment of videos. What we've got here is a short session, mostly with Anthony Edwards, explaining how you row a pair, how you row a pair effectively, and the things to be careful of. So here's some videos on the particular aspects of rowing a pair.
Pair can be an easy boat to row, but it also can be an extremely difficult boat to row. One of the things you often hear comments from people who row a pair was, I was pulling that person around. It was always going around to bow side. I'm too strong for them. It's not a good pair combination. It's actually incorrect. It actually identifies to me, or to our coach, that what they're actually doing is incorrect. They don't understand the feel of a pair, don't understand the rhythm. Because rowing a pair is about working together. It's probably one of the ultimate boats of working together and teamwork. So when we look at rowing a pair, when they come up to the catch, now if someone rams their blades in, it's only natural that it's going to pull around. Okay? So it's about getting the blades in and placed at exactly the same time. So in order to do that, they have to work together. Now as they run into the catch, the bow blade and the stroke blade have to go in. Classic rowing comment, timing, the catch. Now as soon as someone puts the pressure on early, it's going to pull it around to one side and vice versa. A good way to find out whether that's happening, the strokeman can see the very stern of the boat. If my fingers were the very stern of the boat, you'd see a twitch. So if it was going to go to the bow side, you'd see a twitch. Or stroke side, you'd see a twitch. All right? And the strokeman can talk to the bowman and tell him what's going on so that we can identify a free flowing boat and not a twitchy boat off the catch. So timing the placement of the catch in a pair is important. All right, so when rowing a pair, one of the important things in working together, the two seats that are clearly different, but yet you've got to think the same. Two minds thinking about one thing, making a boat go fast. All right, for the strokeman, he's thinking about getting out to the front and being nice and sharp on the catch and getting that blade in and pressing on. All right, being dynamic, keeping the rhythm, keeping the pace. The bowman, his job is to let his strokeman have first dig at it, first place. Don't take it off him. I.e., if I was in bow and I went to go like that at the catch, I'm leaving my stroke man, seeing the catch sort of feel a pull from the bow seat. All right, so while a strokeman needs to get it on nice and sharp and dynamic at the catch, the bowman's job is to come up to the catch, let the strokeman get the first person, sit nice and strong at the catch, place, connect the seat, the feet, the blade, all locked in. We've got connection of the boat, hold it against the stroke blade. Okay, so he's placed in the bow seat, he's holding the pressure against the strokeman's connection in the water. All right, always let your strokeman have first purchase.
Another aspect about a pair that is particularly useful when training a school crew, for example, like an eight or indeed any larger boat, is that you can use a pair as a way to make sure that the athletes can learn from each other. For example, if you have a pair or have a program where you use pairs in your eights program, then what I'd suggest you do is arrange for your more technically proficient rowers to row in the bow seat of a pair and put another rower who is less proficient in the stroke seat. What you can do then is you can use the bow person to help educate the stroke person on how to row more effectively. And if they understand how a pair works and they understand how to row well, then they should be able to impart a lot of knowledge to the other person in the boat by working one-on-one. Because if they're not working together in a pair, it's really obvious, whereas in an eight, it's not. So I'd suggest break your crews up into pairs if you can, and try to put the best person in the bow seat and the less experienced person in the stroke seat, and get them to try and work together cooperatively to try and improve the boat. When you put them back into the eight, you'll find you get a much better outcome. Yes, a pair is a different boat from an eight. It's got different velocity characteristics, it stops more every stroke, etc. But the basic technique fundamentals are the same. So I suggest use pairs to make your eight go faster. Just following here, we have two bits of video in relation to how to deal with a sweep oar and the body positions during the stroke. And the reason we put them into this pairs section of the website, as well as in the other area, is that we think that they're so important, particularly in a pair, to get them to work together. If they haven't got their handle operations and the way they deal with the oar and the way they deal with their bodies, then they're unlikely to work together. So I think it's worth a look. So here it is, and then we have a few more tips on the back end of the video.
I want to talk about hand grip when it comes to sweepboard rowing. I've got a sweepboard handle here. Sometimes we get handles, people down here. Sometimes we get people up here. Tension, all sorts of variations. Okay? Relaxed hand grip is the most important thing. Good way to try that when you're out there on the water as a coach, tell them to pretend they're playing the piano. That'll get relaxation in the hands. All right? When we talk about the hand grip, hand always goes on the end of the oar. Go two fist grips along, and that's pretty much the grip you want. Why do you want that? If you look at where my shoulders are, they're running pretty much straight down. Shoulder width apart. Okay, and that's a good hand grip. That's a good strong position to be able to really drive off that catch. Okay. When we look at the actual hand grip and the pressure on the hand grip, sometimes we see a lot of this, in particular women's rowing, turning and feathering with both hands, and then obviously then coming up to the catch and on vice versa up here. And you probably notice that if I come up the catch, there's tension in the shoulders, and if I came through the finish, the slumping and the elbows pointing down. All right? We look at how that works. The inside hand is the hand that does the feathering. The outside hand is the lever. It hangs off the handle. So the inside hand does the feathering. Inside hand there does the feathering. And the outside hand stays flat. Alright, not both of them. Alright, just the one. Alright. Now when we come to the finish position, if we had both of them feathering, we create that position. Slump body. Elbows down, and it's not a good position. That can also impact people trying to row away because they feel uncomfortable, and all sorts of uncomfortable feelings at the finish. So we want a nice relaxed outside hand hanging off. Naturally it has an impact where body's up, strong position, elbows through, and in a strong position there. All right, nice and relaxed. And then it just flows away. From the inside hand, again if it's tense, all right, tension there is tension there. If I relax that, I've got a relaxed shoulder. Alright, I'll tense again, tense shoulder. Relax it, relax shoulder. Alright, so if I come through the finish, if I'm tension, I'm going to feather. Again, I'm forcing my body down into a bad finish position. If I'm relaxed, where I can release nice and relax, I can sit strong at the finish with the inside hand blowing away. Okay. So just looking at it, if I was coming to the catch position through to the finish position with good relaxed hand grips, I'm coming through, I'm rowing on bow side, for instance, I'd come through, okay, in a strong position, and you notice a swivel of the outside hand hanging relaxed. See that swivel there? So, just rowing through. So you notice the elbows positions come through, and we're just swiveling that relaxed outside hand on top of the oar. Okay, see that position there? Outside elbow, inside elbow. Okay, nice strong position. Not slumped, not up, relaxed position.
I hope that you enjoyed those short videos by Anthony on how to cooperate in a pair and how to make a pair move well by really cooperating within the boat, because that's absolutely vital in that particular type of boat. Important again that the athletes control their posture in the boat. Also important is how they take the catch and to make sure that they're not unstable at the catch. So what I suggest you do in order to help the athletes improve that position is arrange it so that you have the boat and we do what we call circle work, where one of the athletes on either side, doesn't matter, they put their blade flat on the water and balance the boat. And they have to actively work to balance the boat because they're the only person doing it in the boat. Then have the other person row normal stroke, where they're trying to make sure they get the catch placement really well, good connection through the legs, and drive it through and have a very clean tap out. Now if you do that, of course the pair is going to go in a circle, so you need quite a large space of water to do this. And better, of course, if it's calm, because you've got someone balancing on the water. So I suggest that you do that, and at the same time I suggest that you try to emphasize how they take the catch. And following here is a piece of video that I think is particularly useful for that. It's filmed in an 8, but the principles are the same, where you ask the athlete who's doing the rowing to use their inside arm only and to really feel for that catch. So when they take the catch, to really feel that they've got the blade hooked onto the water before they drive with their legs. Now in doing that, you'll find that they get a really good catch and they're well connected before they drive. Then I suggest you ask them to put their outside hand on the blade at the same time, and but continue the same sensation of how it feels. So I've got a short piece of video of doing that in an 8, and I think you'll find that it's a useful technique both for an 8 and a pair, but when you're doing circle work in a pair, it's a particularly good way to focus on getting well connected at the catch. Of course, you do one side of the boat and then swap and do the other. So I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Hello guys, let's go again. Let's have the outside hand back on your hip again.
No delay.
Feel for that water, make sure you get that catch really smooth. No jerk in the boat. When I coil, we'll put the outside hand back on again. So take off your hip, back onto the oar. On this one, maintain that same smoothness around the catch, making sure you pick the water up, pick it carefully before you drive, so we don't end up with that jerk in the boat. Much better, much smoother.
I hope that those pieces of footage, particularly those of Anthony demonstrating how to row a pair effectively, are useful to you. And if you want more information on general rowing, sweep rowing and sculling, of course, but we have a large amount of sweep rowing information on the website dealing with particularly the view from the coxswain seat and exercises to do in an 8. So enjoy. Thank you.